sits with red teaming orchestration in general. Okay, it's going to work. So what's the agenda today? We're going to talk about, I want to cover the basics of the Azure Kubernetes architecture, and then the Kubernetes access control briefly, and then the Kubernetes authorization, and I'll be focused on role-based access control. Then I'll be demonstrating an attack on Grafana Enterprise version 8.3.0. We're going to abuse the role-based access control and elevate the privilege, compromising the infrastructure on Azure. And then I'll talk about node authorization, which is particular authorizations. And I'll also demonstrate how an attacker with the right access could maintain a persistence within the AKS environment, basically essentially accessing all the sensitive, all the stuff that sits on your infrastructure. And I will go through the Azure Kubernetes schedule risks. These are some of the inherent risks. If you have AKS deployed and you haven't done much security around it, you will have these by default. So I'm assuming most of you hopefully know much about Kubernetes orchestration services. When it comes to the cloud architecture, particularly AKS, there's two sections. One is the Azure managed service, and there's the customer managed service. What I mean by that, when you deploy AKS deployment, Azure Kubernetes, essentially you don't have access to the master API or etcd database or scheduler or control manager. However, as a customer, you would have access to underlying node. So you would have access to the AKS nodes, the container runtime, kubelet, and the kproxy, which is, handles the network element. This is very basics of touching access control system, Kubernetes, in a very basic level here. You can go into this deep, far more details than this. But generally, these are the phases when a client or a pod or a service account needs to go through in order to access a Kubernetes object. So let's imagine that you're a user, you have a correct authentication, and you're using kubectl, which is a common binary that you track with Kubernetes. You first have to authenticate, then you have to go through authorizations, and then admission controller, and then you eventually will have, provided that you satisfy all these three criteria, then you'll be able to basically to essentially make the changes on the Kubernetes objects. So for instance, the authentication here, I haven't covered the authentication here, but generally authentication with AKS could be OpenID, it could be part of your Azure Active Directory, it could be tied back to your Azure your on-premise Active Directory, or it could be certificate-based. So the authentication on the cloud, of course, there's a list of authentications, but when it comes to on-premise, that could also be certificate, it could be token, it could be a different way of authenticating to the Kubernetes. So once you pass the authentications, you have to go through authorization, which is we're going to spend quite some time on the authorization element. When you pass the authentication, you have to go through your authorization. Essentially, it's checking whether your user has the right to make the changes in the Kubernetes object. Once it passed the authorization, which this instance basically authorization ID, by default, AKS uses RAC, role-based access control. So by default, RAC is enabled. Even if you satisfied the authentication and authorizations. If your admission control, if your request is not compliant based on your admission controller, your request will get denied. So what I mean by that, the admission controller has the last decision here. So let's say that you have a container image that has some vulnerable libraries. You configure your admission controller. Even if a developer with the right permissions, with the right authorization, pushes this container to AKS, if admission controller checks your image and says, okay, this image has such and such vulnerability, I'm not going to allow it to reach the Kubernetes object. So the importance of admission controller here is critical. Authorization. Authorization by default, if we apply this to on-premise, on AKS, RBAC by default is enabled, so role-based access control. But if it's on-premise Kubernetes, then you would have always allow, always deny, which is always allow essentially is every call, basically every request is allowed, and always deny is it blocks all requests. And the RBAC, which we will talk about, is the that basically essentially that the RBAC it's a policy based, which you can control the access into your who can access what and do what exactly in the Kubernetes. And then you have a special authorizations, which known as a node authorization, which is essentially it's your node, it's deployed on basically the node authorization only applies to Kubelet. Kubelet is an agent, sits on the AKS nodes, and the nodes, essentially the Kubelet it's, needs keys in order to interact with the control panels of the control API server, which we will discuss how we can abuse node authorizations, how we can maintain persistence on the Kubernetes. But for me to actually explain the Grafana abuse, exploiting Grafana, so we need to touch on the RBAC, what really RBAC is. RBAC essentially is a method of regulating access into your Kubernetes resource. The access is based on roles and individual. So you can essentially allow particular developer have particular access into this environment. So you can be very granular in terms of who can have access to what and what to do, essentially actions. And the authorization uses this API to drive authorization decisions. RBAC could also be applied to not only user, but also to service accounts, which we will demonstrate in a minute, how we can, if RBAC is misconfigured, how you can abuse misconfigured RBAC and elevate your privilege and gain full controls of the underlying AKS environment. So the key objects of RBAC essentially is role bindings, cluster role, and cluster role bindings. I know it's a lot, it's a mouthful, but it's quite simple in terms of actually the objects. RBAC, the role itself, is a set of roles. It defines set of permissions. So you can have a role that could allow creating pods and read secrets. And then you have a role bindings that assigns that role to that role. Essentially, role binding assigns that role to that role bindings. And then you can essentially create, you can assign those roles to a particular service account or particular user, give them limited access, or you want to give them full access. And you have cluster roles and cluster role bindings. The difference between those two, between the roles and role bindings and cluster role bindings, cluster role and cluster role bindings are not, they are basically not namespace scoped. What it means is that if you assign cluster role and role binding to a user, they can essentially access all the namespaces that within the AKX. However, with a role and role binding, you can be very granular and particular access in a, let's say, a particular namespace as opposed to all the namespaces in the Kubernetes. So, a case of basically overprivileged service accounts. So this was based on an engagement that was involved. I was able to essentially compromise a AKS environment by just identifying a vulnerability in Grafana. So what we have here, we have a Grafana 830 container deployed in a namespace secure, and it's vulnerable to directory traversal. So essentially, directory traversal, if the application is vulnerable to that, you can read a sensitive, you can read remote files on the remote server. So you can essentially read particular sensitive files using that vulnerability. The Grafana by default, 830, actually was assigned a cluster role and cluster role binding by public access. So the cluster role assigned to the Grafana service account, name here, it's overprivileged, and essentially that cluster role has a resource secret that then verb list. Essentially what it means is that you can list secrets on all namespaces within that AKS environment. And then you got the cluster role binding, which is binds the cluster role to the cluster role binding with that name overprivileged bindings. And then having that, you can assign the cluster role binding to a service account known as overprivileged. What does it look like in a YAML file? You've got the Grafana image. It's just it basically pulls that image from Docker Hub, and it's, if you look closely, it listens on a port 3000. And if you look at the bottom, which I'll explain each one of those YAML files in a second, is that it's assigned to a service account known as overprivileged. What does actually the cluster role looks like? So you have a kind cluster role at the top, and then the name is called overprivileged role. The resource can basically access its secrets, and then you can use verb list. Essentially, here that cluster role YAML file tells you that the this cluster role could list secrets on all namespaces in AKS if it's deployed. And the associated role binding here, if you look at the top, API version underneath, kind cluster role bindings, it's the name, it's overprivileged bindings, and essentially it combines the cluster role to the cluster role binding, and it assigns to a service account known as overprivileged in the namespace of SKU. So I have Grafana deployed in a namespace secure, and it's vulnerable to directory traversal. So I can essentially read file from that Grafana application remote server. But also that service account assigned to that container, it has ability to read secrets against all the namespaces in the AKS environment. I'm basically just showing the get service account overprivileged. I'm just demonstrating the JSON format here, that it's the overprivileged cluster role binding assigned to a namespace secure. There are obviously, for an attacker to exploit this, they need to have some level of access into the infrastructure. So they need to have some kind of access to a port, a container within that environment. So here, what I'm demonstrating is there's obviously different ways you could potentially compromise an application, and then you have code executions on to a container, and then you can go from there. So what I've done here essentially, I've deployed a pod. I called it, it's just a busybox, basically container. I called it that busybox, and it's I'm using this as my initial access into the container, into the APS. So imagine I'm an attacker, I've compromised the busybox container in the default namespace, which is important to note. Then I use this busybox container to see what I can do to compromise the entire infrastructure of AKS, essentially abusing the Grafana to a layer of privilege. So as an attacker, if you're an attacker and you have access to a container, this is essentially at the top, I'm accessing into the back busybox. I'm getting shell into the busybox, so a container. The first thing I've done is I'm just setting, asking for the environmental variable. As you can see, first thing first it says Kubernetes, so I know where I am. I'm in a Kubernetes environment. The next thing I want to do, because I know now I am in a Kubernetes environment, I want to start enumerating. I want to know what permissions I have in that environment, so that I can see how I can move laterally into the environment. So I'm here downloading something called kubectl. So, which is, some people call it kubectl. And essentially, it's a binary that it allows you to interact with the control panels of the AKS, so generally cluster. So, the first thing I've done here, the note, kubectl auth, can I list? So, what I'm doing here, I am listing what permissions I have with my existing service account. Because this is a default namespace, my permission is limited. I have literally no permissions. Look at here. So you've got resources, resource name, and verb, create. I pretty much have no, very limited access what I can do here. So I don't have much of a, in terms of privilege to move laterally or access a different container or exploit other things. As an attacker, of course, the first thing I would do is to look at where I am. So I identify what my subnet is within my container. I'm still in a busy box. I'm doing a quick ifconfig. I'm just going to scan the environment. And in this instance, I made it very easy for myself. I'm just doing an nmap port 3000 because I know Grafana is there. But as an attacker, you would obviously identify this information all the time. So Grafana is open. Now that I know Grafana is open, I've done my enumerations, I've identified Grafana is vulnerable to this directory traversal, I'm going to use the busybox container, steal the token on the Grafana application, on the Grafana container, and then use the token to elevate my privilege, which I'll show you now. So if you look at the top here, what I've done here, I've used a simple curl command, path as to the Grafana's application. I'm still in that busy box at the top here. I am essentially asking for, I'm requesting the var run secrets Kubernetes service accounts and the token of the Grafana, which is because this is vulnerable to directory traversal. That the Grafana responds with the token back to me, so to my container, to my busybox. As you can see, it's a token, it's JWT. Now that I have the token of the Grafana, I'm making basically environmental variable here, token, and I am using kubectl, still on the busybox, of can I -- token with a new token. Now, what's interesting is that now I have a list secrets, so I can now list secrets. Essentially, I'm with listing a secret, I can list all the secrets in the AKS environment, or all namespaces. still using what I'm still doing here, essentially. I am still using that token. I'm saying kubectl get secrets in namespace kube system. So I'm asking the control panel, essentially, can you list all the secrets in the one of the most sensitive namespaces in AKS, which is the kube system. Now I can get CA the certificates, the tokens, the bootstrap token, etc. So from now on, basically, essentially, you can use this access to further leverage your access into that environment. We have a demo. Hopefully it works. That will just explain what I've done. Okay. So I'm on my Kali Linux machine. I am doing a kube get NS, so I'm listing all namespaces. Then I am listing the pods in the namespace secure, and as you can see, Grafana is running. And I'm also listing pods in the default namespace, which has bad busybox. Now I am using the bad busybox to gain shell, listing the environmental variable as I demonstrated. So we are in a Kubernetes environment. I'm doing a quick enumerations. So my ID is 1024244314. I'm going to the temporary folder because I'm going to download kubectl, essentially, so that I can interact with the API server. Okay, I can spell. Okay, there you go. I'm just basically curling to bring in the kubectl to my busybox. I'm changing the permission, making it executable. So /kubectl. I'm checking my permission first to see what permission I have. Get pod, I'm forbidden. I have no, my service account is very limited. I'm in a default namespace. It says, cannot list resource pods in an API group. I'm using auth, can I list my essentially permissions? I have no permissions yet. I am doing a quick network mapping of the environment to see where I am. Because I know the file is on there because I deployed it. Makes an interesting thing. Then I'm viewing the port 3000 on the Grafana because that's where the Grafana is actually running on. Now I know the application is vulnerable, so I'm just going to steal the token from the Grafana. I don't know why it took me some time here. There's a delay. Possibly. There we go, I'm using curl, pass-ass, and that vulnerable plugin, and there's a list of vulnerable plugins. As you can see here now, I'm listing the password file on the Grafana for demonstrations that actually the application is vulnerable to directory traversal. So I did, you know, .. etc password. So I got the password file back. Now I know where the actual token is saved for service tokens for the Grafana. So I'm just going to steal that token, use that token to compromise the, elevate my privilege essentially to a level where I can list secrets in the environment. So there we go, var run, secrets, Kubernetes, service account token. And that token essentially is a JWT token. So you can use that token to as an environmental variable to compromise the infrastructure. So this is the JWT token. I'm copying this, making it environmental variable, making sure I'm not copying the root. And this the last bit, which is token equal, I'm making this use kubectl auth, can I list my permissions? Because this is a new token, and this token is assigned cluster role and cluster role binding, which their list on the regions of secrets, now you can essentially list all the secrets in the AKS namespaces. Okay, can you just probably move this? So this was a basic of basically how a RBAC could be misconfigured, in particular because when you deploy a container through Helm or through any other way that you deploy to an AKS, you really need to know what permissions are assigned to those service accounts. So that was the abuse of a role-based access control. But I mentioned earlier that there's a particular authorization to Kubernetes, which is node authorization, which is a special authorization only specific to kubelet. Kubelet, essentially, in Kubernetes terms, it's an agent that sits in the AKS nodes. And the job of the kubelet, essentially, is needs to communicate back to the API server to see if the pods are deployed correctly, if they need to be redeployed, etc., etc. But for kubelet to interact with API server, it needs some keys. So imagine if an attacker managed to actually compromise your node in AKS, which I'll demonstrate is possible, subject to if you deploy your AKS without securing it. So an attacker could essentially steal those keys and interact with your environment externally and have basically list secrets further essentially compromise your infrastructure. So how is that possible? I'm going to demonstrate after a future slide, that how you can actually escape from a container deployed within the AKS into the actual node that maintains those ports. So here what I'm doing is, here that I'm in the node of the AKS, I'm using kubectl, I'm using the keys for kubelet to essentially interact with control panel to lose the secrets. So here, as you can see, kubectl -i kubeconfig get port A. I can list the pods, but I can also list secrets with those keys that kubelet has. This key basically sits in the node, which is essentially your responsibility to manage those nodes. If you're not, let's say, configured admission controller, probably, then an attacker could, with the right permissions, basically store those keys. Now I'll demonstrate how we can escape from the container to the node, steal those keys, and interact with AKS externally as opposed to actually internally. And if you steal those keys, an attacker could basically essentially have a year access to those certificates and interact with your AKS control panel externally. And it's just pretend that it's a kubelet is interacting with your AKS environment. So you are pretending to be a kubelet, an agent, not a user. Here it's, I'm sorry, it's, I know it's, the screen is not great, but it's 1 year valid. And if you look at the object, it said O, so it's the group system nodes. It's essentially a certificate for the kubelet client current append. It's valid for 1 year if it's compromised. And if you have then a quick cap on the actual the kubeconfig file. Essentially what it says is that what I've done here is, as an attacker, I've copied those keys to my own machine. I'm no longer in the BusyBox container. I took those keys back to my own machine, and I am using my own Linux machine, those keys to interact directly with the control panel, because I've stole those keys, and I am actually now impersonating a kubelet as opposed to a user. So I'm doing kubectl -config config, specifying the config, get secret A. So list all the secrets in the Kubernetes API. These are the tokens that you can show, etc. I think I'm conscious of time, left 10 minutes. I'll probably just go to the demo. Conscious of time, so I'm just gonna skip the few slides in terms of how what you can do with the certificate, but I'll show you the demo how you can actually compromise the node, escape from the container to node, and then steal those keys. And you can use those keys outside of the container. So some of the security risks with the AKS are those I actually find all the time when I test the AKS environment. Port security admissions. If you haven't actually deployed port security admissions, an attacker with crate pod could escape your container and get into the node, steal those keys, and then maintain full access to your AKS environment for 1 year. So what's port security admission? By default, is there in AKS. Essentially, but it is not enabled. So a port security admission, it's a standard policy and basically applies to all the ports running in the namespaces. And there are levels to it. So the port security levels, there is a privilege baseline and restricted. So a port security level, a privilege, essentially, it means that a user have all the access of that namespaces. A baseline, essentially, it's a set of rules that's developed by AKS team, which is the baseline rules that would limit you from what you can do from the perspective. And then you've got restricted, which is very strict set of rules that limit you to do much if you apply it from the attack point of view. And then there's security modes. You've got enforce, audit, and a warrant, so which is one. So what I'm essentially doing here, I'm just showing you a manifest file here, is that if you haven't applied the admission controller, an attacker with basic crate pod could mount the host file, the root file, on the actual node that this pod is running on. So what I'm doing here, what an attacker could do is, you can, because of the specs of, if you look at closely, it's a security context, privileged equal true. This manifest file essentially says, this manifest file has all the access it needs. What it does, when it's deployed, it mounts the host, it mounts the basically root file on the actual node itself into a mount path host. So if I deploy this, I'm no longer essentially in a container. I am basically mounting the root directory, then I can root into that root directory and steal those keys in a node, and then interact with your kubelet. Basically take all those keys and then interact with the APIs. So how does it look like? Essentially what I'm doing here, I'm using that manifest file, kubectl apply, and the work node YAML in a secure namespace, and it gets deployed, and because it's mounted the root file on the node, all I have to do now is enter into that container and then kubeboot /host. And then now, if you look at the actual the name, the actual I'm no longer basically in the I've escaped the container, now I'm actually in the agent pool VM that manages all your containers. So at this point, basically game over. There's an attacker that can go to the specific folder in the node, steal those keys, and interact with Cube API Server. That's what the demo looks like. Hopefully, it's this demo. I think I have to cut short because there's a lot more to talk about in terms of schedule risks. Okay, so what I'm doing here, I'm doing keep, I'm on my machine, I'm doing kubectl get pod in the namespace of secure. I am just showing you a YAML file that I just showed you earlier. It's a security context privileged equal true, so it allows you to essentially mount the host file, the root file of the node. And the name of it is called, so now I'm applying the kubectl apply, the I call it ttp.yaml in the secure namespace. Now it's deployed because admission control is not there, so I can deploy it. Now I can say kubectl get pod in the secure namespace. Now my container is deployed. I can just do kubectl exec into that pod. And there's a musical background with me when I recorded it. So I'm executing into the pod I deployed. Now as you can see, I did a who am I hostname, aka agent. So I'm no longer in the container environment. I'm essentially in the underlying VM. Now as an attacker, I just go to varlib kubelet. I have essentially all the certificates that the kubelet uses to track with the API server. I steal those keys. Now I have access to the environment for 1 year. So a very stealth persistence from point of an attacker because they have access. Only one thing is to note is that with this certificate, you can't exit into any containers, but you can list secrets because it's part of the cluster role and cluster role binding assigned to this node. It only allows you get config maps and list secrets. And as you can see, that I can list secrets with the actual stored keys. Conscious of time, so the moral of the story is, it's one thing to, I might get more basically recommendation, but one of the things that if you haven't done is apply the PSA, so post security admission control, if you haven't done this. Because that just instantly, if you apply the baseline rules, that would completely kill that attack vector. And the next basically security concern is essentially restricting access to your community API server. So if you deploy AKS, by default GCP, AWS, all the Kubernetes that I know, deployments in cloud, are essentially exposed to the public. Which, this is the default settings for all the cloud providers. So if an attacker basically, even if an attacker managed to steal those keys, but if the API server is not exposed, essentially it's useless. So what you want to do is, as well is to make sure that your AKS control panel is not exposed to the public, which you can easily mitigate this by actually so I'm demonstrating here how an attacker could actually abuse this. Here I am essentially listing my the control panel, so my public DNS control panel, and I've done a quick scan against it, which runs on, for some reason, AKS runs on SSH publicly on port 9000, security through obscurity, and also runs on the port 443 for the control panel, makes sense. And so an attacker essentially could also not only steal in keys, but if an attacker managed to get a service token internally, they can use that service token externally to interact with your API server. So the takeaway here is that if your control panel is not exposed to the public, even if I have service tokens, what do I do with it? Unless I have access to your terminal. last one I would probably touch on this is this. By default, SSH, basically, all the pods, by default, if AKS has access to all the cluster. So they, in terms of networking, there is no, the networking is not segregated, so you can just interact with any pod within the environment, essentially. But also note that AKS nodes, they run SSH service. So any pod within AKS deployment can essentially compromise one of the SSHs on the nodes, and then you can use that as a privilege as well. Conscious of time, it's zero, so I'm just going to cut it here, but I've got more motivation